Good morning. Let us have a moment of silence as we ponder over today. I'm not high and mighty, Lord. I'm not rich. It doesn't occur to me to think myself privileged. In fact, I often moan. When I do that, it's because I have stopped looking around me, mirrored in self-interest. I see only my own world. Help me to look beyond my bubble, Father. Burst my bubble. Open my eyes. Make me aware. And from awareness, awaken action. I pray. Amen.
Please stand. The Lord be with you. Good morning, everyone. It's lovely to see you here. We all survived the storm. Well done. No one got blown away. As we gather here this morning, we're going to be thinking about the God whom we've come to worship. So let's worship God now using that lovely setting of Isaiah 33, glorious things of thee are spoken.
Thank you.
Let us continue our service with a prayer of preparation. Together we say, Almighty God, with whom all hearts are open, all desires known, and from whom no secrets are hidden, cleanse the thoughts of our hearts by the inspiration of your Holy Spirit, that we may perfectly magnify your holy name through Christ our Lord. Amen. Our Lord Jesus Christ said, the first commandment is this, Hear, O Israel, the Lord our God is the only Lord. You shall love the Lord your God with all your heart, with all your soul, with all your mind, and with all your strength. The second is this, Love your neighbor as yourself. There is no other commandment greater than these. On these two commandments hang all the laws and prophets. Amen. Lord, have mercy. Lord so loved the world that he gave his only Son, Jesus Christ, to save us from our sins, to be our advocate in heaven, and to bring us to eternal life. Let us confess our sins in penitence and faith, firmly resolved to keep God's commandments and to live in love and peace with all. Almighty God, our Heavenly Father, we have sinned against you and against our neighbor, in thought and word and deed, through negligence, through weakness, through our own deliberate fault. We are truly sorry and repent of all our sins. For the sake of your Son, Jesus Christ, who died for us, forgive us all that is past, and grant that we may serve you in the newness of life, through the glory of your name. Amen.
Almighty God, who forgives all who truly repent, have mercy upon you, pardon and deliver you from all your sins, confirm and strengthen you in all goodness, and bring you to everlasting life through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen.
To Christians throughout the world, let us say our colleague for today. Lord God, defend your church from all false teaching and give to your people knowledge of your truth, that we may enjoy eternal life. In Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. Please be seated for our readings. Good morning. The first reading is from Genesis chapter 50, verses 15 through 21. Realizing that their father was dead, Joseph's brothers said, "What if Joseph still bears a grudge against us and pays us back in full for all the wrong that we did to him?" So they approached Joseph, saying, "Your father gave this instruction before he died. Say to Joseph, 'I beg you, forgive the crime of your brothers and the wrong they did in harming you. Now, therefore, please forgive the crime of the servants of the God of your father.'" Joseph wept when they spoke to him. Then his brothers also wept, fell down before him and said, "We are here as your slaves." But Joseph said to them, "Do not be afraid. Am I in the place of God? Even though you intended to harm me, God intended it for good in order to preserve a numerous people, as he is doing today. So have no fear. I myself will provide for you and your little ones." In this way, he reassured them, speaking kindly to them. This is the word of the Lord. The second reading is from Romans chapter 14, verses 1 through 12. Welcome those who are weak in faith, but not for the purpose of quarreling over opinions. Some believe in eating anything, while the weak eat only vegetables. Those who eat must not despise those who abstain, and those who abstain must not pass judgment on those who eat, for God has welcomed them. Who are you to pass judgment on servants of another? It is before their own Lord that they stand or fall, and they will be upheld, for the Lord is able to make them stand. Some judge one day to be better than another, while others judge all days to be alike. Let all be fully convinced in their own minds. Those who observe the day, observe it in the honor of the Lord, and those who eat, eat in honor of the Lord, since they give thanks to God, while those who abstain, abstain in honor of the Lord and give thanks to God. We do not live to ourselves, and we do not die to ourselves. If we live, we live to the Lord, and if we die, we die to the Lord. So then, whether we live or whether we die, we are the Lord's. For to this end, Christ died and lived again, so that he might be Lord of both the dead and the living. Why do you pass judgment on your brothers or sister? Or you, why do you despise your brother or sister? For we will all stand before the judgment seat of God, for it is written, "As I live, says the Lord, every knee shall bow to me, and every tongue shall give praise to God." So then each of us will be accountable to God. This is the word of the Lord.
Our hymn before the gospel reading and sermon is number 434. Restore, O Lord, the honor of your name.
Thank you.
Hear the gospel of our Lord Jesus Christ according to Matthew. Then Peter came and said to him, Lord, if another member of the church sins against me, how often should I forgive? As many as 7 times. Jesus said to him, not 7 times, but I tell you, 77 times. For this reason, the kingdom of heaven may be compared to a king who wished to settle an account with his slaves. When he began the reckoning, one who owed him 10,000 talents was brought to him, and as he could not pay, his lord ordered him to be sold together with his wife and children and all his possessions and payment to be made. So the slave fell on his knees before him, saying, have patience with me, and I will pay you everything. And out of pity for him, the lord of that slave released him and forgave him the debt. But that slave, as he went out, came upon one of his fellow slaves who owed him about 100 denarii, and seizing him by the throat, he said, pay me what you owe. Then this fellow slave fell down and pleaded with him, have patience with me, and I will pay you. But he refused, and went and threw him into prison until he should pay the debt. When his fellow slaves saw what had happened, they were greatly distressed. And they went and reported to their lord all that had taken place. And then his lord summoned him and said to him, you wicked slave, I forgave you all that debt because you pleaded with me. Should you not have had mercy on your fellow slave as I had mercy on you? And in his anger, his lord handed him over to be tortured until he should pay his entire debt. So my Father in heaven will also do to every one of you if you do not forgive your brother or sister from your heart. This is the gospel of the Lord. Let us pray. Lord, in brokenness, we come to you with broken words and broken lives, and only in you are we made whole. We offer this time to you now, not because we have anything to offer, but because we would hear your word in our hearts. To the glory of your name, amen. Please be seated. As some of you will know, I'm from the Black Country in the UK. I think it would be described by a realtor as a vibrant area. If you don't know what that euphemism means, you might want to talk to a realtor. You don't want to live there. And I went to a very ordinary school there, and fair to say, didn't really enjoy school very much. Didn't really get on that well. Also didn't fit in with the other kids. But you will be completely unsurprised to hear that I was quite a precocious kid. I know it's a shock, but there you go. And I didn't really get on with any of the classes until one day we had a new teacher in our English class, and I was bored senseless, and he came in and he opened my eyes to a different way of understanding the world and the way in which we talk about the world in which we live and the way in which we use language, and I will be ever grateful to him. And I will never forget his first lesson, which was on poetry, which quite honestly until that point I found deathly boring. And he read to me some poetry, and by the end of that class, I was so excited by the idea of poetry that I went out and bought a book, and this is that book. And this is one of the poems that he read to us, and one of the ones that really inspired me to start thinking about the world and everything in it. It's by the poet William Blake, who I'm sure you've probably heard of but may not know much of his poetry. You probably know his poem, Jerusalem, and Did Those Feet in Ancient Time. Know that one? This is his one called A Poison Tree. You may know it. I was angry with my friend. I told my wrath. My wrath did end. I was angry with my foe. I told it not. My wrath did grow. And I watered it with fears, night and morning with my tears. And I sunnet it with smiles and with soft, deceitful wiles. And it grew both day and night till it bore an apple bright. And my foe beheld it shine, and he knew that it was mine. And into my garden stole when the night had veiled the pole, and in the morning glad I see my foe outstretched beneath the tree. The world is full of difficult relationships, as we've been hearing over the last few weeks, and as we've been thinking about. But one of the biggest problems with broken human relationships is that desire that is in some of us stronger than others to win. To win. When there is an argument, the idea is not to find reconciliation, but to win. Not even to be proved right, just to be the one who ends up on top. And of course, that poem reveals that very, very powerful desire inside people. Think of the last argument you had with someone. All kinds of situations in which we have disagreements, obviously. But it is this desire to win, to be on top, that is quite so damaging. And into this situation walks Jesus and starts talking about forgiveness. And we can think of those sort of truisms or aphorisms that we hear sometimes about this kind of poisonous idea around the lack of forgiveness and what it does to human beings. So if you heard the line, not forgiving someone is like drinking poison and expecting your enemy to die. Have you heard that one? It's very common. And that poem sort of picks up on that idea, that there is a poison inside a lack of forgiveness that does huge damage to human beings. And so we come up with this line, therefore we must forgive. And I know what that's trying to get at, and I think it's sort of right, but I also think it's slightly fatuous, because I don't think forgiveness quite works like that. It's very easy for those who have very little to forgive to say how important forgiving others is. It's very easy. I think that those who have faced some of the most awful and horrendous abuses and loss of life probably would have a different perspective on that. I don't know. I've not been through it. But I do note that this week we had a storm, and we all survived. Well done. We had a few moans about loss of power. Anyone lost power? Okay. Yeah, I mean, it happens. We can have a little moan about that. But I think we look over at the storms in places like Greece and Libya, and we look at the loss of property and, above all, life. We see the damage done to particularly impoverished nations when huge storms hit them. And we go, at least I hope we do, our suffering is not like that. And so we feel very blessed and very lucky, and that's great. And I hope we're able to do the same thing when we come across folk who've been really, really damaged by the abuses of others, and they find it hard to forgive. I hope that we show the same level of grace. And when Jesus is speaking here, I don't think he's saying to people who face those kinds of challenges, Well, you've just got to forgive them, or God will zap you. I don't think that's what Jesus is saying at all. There are lots of reasons why I don't think Jesus is saying that. First of all, because I think we need to be very careful that we don't take the king in the image that Jesus gives us, the parable that he tells. I don't think we want to take that king and say, God's like that. I don't think that's quite what Jesus is saying. There's a story. It's just a parable is just a story. You don't take a parable apart and say, oh, right, well, the king is God and the slave is us. It doesn't work like that. It's just a story to help you understand something. And you have to sit with the story and just let it be. And, you know, obviously in that story that the debt that is owed is astronomical and unpayable compared to the debt that the one slave has with the other. Now, if you want to talk about first century slavery, I'm very happy to have that conversation at another time. But it's just to do with the way in which Jesus is telling the story in his context. And we need to be very careful that we don't get too simplistic about it. So what is being said here? Well, I think the first thing I want to do is draw out a couple of things that are not being said. What's not being said is that somehow forgiveness does us good. You know, as if the Bible were a self-help manual telling us how to live a good life that was positive for us, you know, and to make the world a better place. That's not what the Bible is doing. It doesn't, I mean, it's a byproduct of all the things that the Bible says, but that's not why it's there. It's not saying you need to forgive others because otherwise you'll have a horrible life. The Bible tells us about who God is. It tells us about our relationship with God. That things that go on in the human world are things that go on in the human world. They just happen. They happen all over the world all the time. And they're not really about that interpersonal way of us dealing or international or however you want to look at it. We can draw wisdom from it, but really it's telling us about God. And you can see that in that lovely reading from Genesis 50. It's such a beautiful story, that, where Joseph, has finally been revealed to his brothers, and he's told them to go away and come back. And by the time they've come back, his father's died. And so they're like, oh, we can't tell him his father's died. He'll kill us. This is awful. And so they make up this ridiculous lie about the fact that as their father was dying, his last words were, and tell Joseph to forgive you. I mean, it didn't happen. Joseph's not a fool. He's been running Egypt, for goodness sake. He knows how this works. He's had people lie to him all day, every day. He knows they're lying. And he forgives them with tears from his heart. Not because it does him any good, but because the Bible is trying to tell us something about who God is. And the Bible is telling us that human beings are supposed to replicate the characteristics of God. God is forgiving, therefore we are forgiving. Not God is forgiving, therefore it's a good idea for us to forgive, or God is forgiving and therefore it does us good if we forgive as well. God is forgiving, therefore we are forgiving. And there's still a but to that. And I want to draw something that I think really helps us to understand what Jesus is getting at when we look at this lovely reading from Romans. Remember, all of our readings are on our... Diana's just put it up in the WhatsApp chat. St. Paul's Paget.online.church. All the readings are in there, so you can look them up anytime if you haven't got your Bible on you. And in there, St. Paul says something that, if you were listening, I hope made you go, ooh, that's a bit clunky. That's not very well worded. If you didn't, I'll just read it to you. Because it's odd wording, I think, helps us to understand this idea of forgiveness that Jesus is getting at, possibly more than anything else, or at least this is what struck me this week anyway. So if it doesn't strike you, enjoy the sleep, and I'll finish in about 5 minutes. So St. Paul writes this. This is verse 8. We do not live to ourselves, and we do not die to ourselves. If we live, we live to the Lord.
And if we die, we die to the Lord. So then, whether we live or whether we die, we are the Lord's. For to this end Christ died and lived again, so that he might be Lord of both the dead and the living. And I hope you found that clunky, because I think it would read much better if it was translated like this. We do not live for ourselves. We don't die for ourselves. If we live, we live for God, and if we die, we die for the Lord. So then, whether we live or whether we die, we are the Lord's. For to this end, Christ died and lived again, so that he might be the Lord of both the dead and the living. Does that feel a bit better? We don't live for ourselves. We don't die for ourselves. We live for God. If we die, we die for God, because we belong to God. Does that make sense? It sounds a lot smoother to me. Like I say, it could just be me. So this idea of we don't live to ourselves and we don't die to ourselves, and we live to God and we die to God, just sounds a bit odd. And it's supposed to. It's supposed to because of what's being said here. As I said, we don't forgive because it does us good. So also we don't forgive as some kind of offering to God. Our forgiveness is not for God, in the same way that our lives are not for God or our deaths aren't for God. God doesn't get anything out of our forgiveness or our lives or our death. It's not for him. It's not some kind of offering that we make as if we make some kind of sacrifice that was worth anything, which we say at Holy Communion, by the way. No sacrifice we ever make is ever worth anything. That's not what's being said. So you can't say we don't live for ourselves, we don't die for ourselves. If we live for God, and if we die, we die for the Lord. It makes no sense, because we don't have anything to offer. Instead, it means this. God is really God, and his characteristic is that he forgives. So our worship of God, our recognition of the absolute almightiness of God, is to forgive. It's not an offering, it's a response to the majesty of God, to the grace of God. Does that make sense? The God is just unbelievable. Like, God is indescribable. And we struggle as humans to respond to that. But one of the responses that we do make, not as an offering, but just because we stand before this mighty God and go, oh my goodness, that it's natural that we forgive. And that puts a different emphasis on it. Because I don't know about you, but I do know about Jesus. And that he talks about how difficult it is for human beings to worship a God they can't see. He does say that. You know, blessed are you, you've seen me and you've believed. But blessed are those who have not seen and yet believe. He understands how difficult it is for us. And you and I can't see God. But something about who God is does strike us in such a way as that we do respond by forgiving. And what that means is, when we are able to connect with forgiving, it will be absolute from our heart. But it might not be a once thing, and it might not be something that is instantaneous. You know, someone does a bad thing, I forgive them. It doesn't work quite like that. I think it's much more like we catch glimpses of real forgiveness as we catch glimpses of the majesty of God. Now, we should strive to see God, and we should also strive to forgive. I don't think it's helpful to beat ourselves up when something horrendous has happened and we find it difficult to forgive, as if somehow it ought to be natural for Christians, because it isn't. But it is a work of God within us. So I think what's really going on here is it is about our relationship with God. If we don't know who God is, we will find it hard to forgive. Impossible sometimes. But if we know who God is, and we know his spirit living within us, we will catch those glimpses in the fire of his love of grace and mercy coming at those moments when we turn to him constantly and say, I don't know how to forgive in this situation. I don't have a mechanism by which to do this. And we catch a glimpse of what forgiveness would look like. And we just grasp it for a moment, and then it goes again. But we come back to it because we remember. And forgiveness becomes this process, not this once thing. Bad thing happens, I forgive you, and we all move on. I don't think that's what happens. I think what happens is that a bad thing happens and we are hurt and damaged and broken and the relationship is broken. But in God, we start to see what it might look like in little flashes of fire. And if we grasp those, we start to move towards it. So if you are one of those people who takes umbrage at everything, can I encourage you to come close to God? Because in your closeness to the almighty and majestic God, you will find it much easier to let go. If you are one of those people who has had something horrendous happen to you, please stop beating yourself up if you're finding it difficult or impossible to forgive. Come close to God and see if you can catch glimpses of what forgiveness, even in another situation, might look like. Not because it will do you good, but because of who God is. It is this process of learning to forgive, I think, that Jesus is talking about. Because the debt is forgiven, and us releasing the debts that others have accrued with us will be dependent upon the size of that debt. The king might be able to forgive in one go. We might have to do it over time, but come close to him and catch the glimpse of his majesty. Let's pray. Lord Jesus, in you and on your cross, we see the absolute nature of the forgiveness of God, and we struggle to understand it, the why you would offer it to the most horrendous human beings, amongst whom, of course, we do not count ourselves. And sometimes we undervalue our own forgiveness. And sometimes we undervalue your majesty and your power. And so we offer to you the brokenness of our lives. And we say, we would draw close to you. We are not worthy. But we would want to forgive, as we have been forgiven, at least to that level, and maybe beyond. Can we reach your cross? Only by your Spirit. Only then can we know true forgiveness for ourselves and to those who have sinned against us. Lord, as we draw and take our first steps closer to you, please, come to us and meet us where we are. To your glory. Amen. Let's stand together and profess the shared faith of the church. We believe in one God, the Father, the Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, of all that is seen and unseen. We believe in one Lord, Jesus Christ, the only Son of God, eternally begotten of the Father, God from God, light from light, true God from true God, begotten, not made, of one being with the Father. Through him all things were made. For us and for our salvation, he came down from heaven, was incarnate from the Holy Spirit and the Virgin Mary, and was made man. For our sake, he was crucified under Pontius Pilate. He suffered death and was buried. On the third day, he rose again in accordance with the scriptures.
He ascended into heaven and is seated at the right hand of the Father. He will come again in glory to judge the living and the dead, and his kingdom will have no end. We believe in the Holy Spirit, the Lord, the giver of life, who proceeds from the Father and the Son, who with the Father and the Son is worshipped and glorified, who has spoken through the prophets. We believe in one holy Catholic and apostolic church. We acknowledge one baptism for the forgiveness of sins. We look for the resurrection of the dead and the life of the world to come. Amen. If someone could go and let the Sunday school know that they've got a few minutes before it's time to join us, that'd be great. Thank you. Looks like someone's going. Thank you very much. We will kneel together in intercession as Kaywell leads us in the prayers that we have for the world. Thank you, Kaywell.
Lord, open our hearts to your love and glory and our eyes and ears to your presence. Keep us faithful to your teachings and our fellowship as we unite in prayer here this morning. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. Lord, help us to strengthen the bonds of the Anglican Communion and take away all prejudices that cause unequal treatment of others that feel alienated by the church. We pray for Christians and non-Christians who are willing to risk their lives in the troubled spots of the world in order to build bridges of understanding between people of different races and color. We pray for Bishop Nick, Canon Ant, the Christian family of St. Paul's, religious leaders, and all who promote outreach into the community. We pray all members of the ordained ministries and for all those who spread your word throughout the world. We give you thanks and grant that all may be built up in their faith. We recognize that the work of helping people who can be vulnerable to spiritual attack, and pray that they won't allow criticism or negativity to hinder their ministry. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. Lord, we give thanks and ask you to bless all those who seek to make peace in our divided world, and for those who are prepared to work long hours and travel widely to any country in the cause of peace. We remember before you all who work or live in dangerous places or hostile environments, all who are suffering at this time from storms. May we become totally aware of their needs and respond positively and quickly so that we can play a real part in bringing hope to those in despair. We give thanks to the Bermuda Regiment, our police and fire services, and huge thanks to our Belco linesmen who brave the elements, join Lee and Franklin. Lord, we pray for that the leaders of the nations and people everywhere may turn to you so that war and terror, cruelty and hatred may end, and peace and justice, kindness and love reigns. Our thoughts today are especially with people caught up in violence and conflict, which continues unabated. We pray that you will give courage and wisdom to all to do what is right. And we pray for our world where we see the misery and tragedy brought about by wrong choices. We pray for wisdom and compassion in all negotiations and decisions taken by our world and government leaders, and ask that there be humility in leadership and responsibility. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. Lord, teach us to be generous, that it is more blessed to give than to receive. Remind us that the world and our community need good Samaritans. And in these times of economic hardship, we pray for all food banks that work tirelessly to provide for the hungry. We pray for people whose lives are insecure, for those whose relationships are at risk, or who have become captive to drugs, having to depend on others. Give them the strength and courage to deal with each new day. We pray for all those who have strayed from their faith, especially those whose lives are in danger as a result. We pray that you will bless our homes, families, and friends, and all whom we love and care for. May we always be ready to respect and value them. Lord, help us to use our influence and talents you have given us to bring peace, joy, and fun into people's lives instead of stirring up strife. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. Lord, we pray for our young children and people embarking on the next stage of their life's journey as they go off to their respective schools and universities. We ask that you make them aware of your unending love and the many new challenges they will face and the relationships they will form. Guide our principals, teachers, and students towards their goals in education and in citizenship. Grant them the enthusiasm and joy as they work towards a fulfilled and satisfying future. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. Lord, we pray for all who carry heavy burdens. Refresh us with your presence. We pray that you will bless those suffering through poverty, malnutrition, and disease. For those who are weary with relentless struggle to stay alive, and those lacking in the basic necessities of life, which we so readily take for granted. Support all healthcare staff, visitors, and volunteers who work to bring relief. We also pray for the bereaved and the thousands of children who still die every day from hunger and disease. We ask your blessing on all who are sick at home, in hospital, or hospice. Lord, we remember all who are burdened by their circumstances in life, and we pray for all displaced persons hoping for a better life in another country. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. Lord, we pray for those who have departed this life. May they rest in peace and rise in glory. For those who mourn their passing, that leaning on you, they may know the consolation of your love. We pray especially for those known to us who are in need of our prayers and whom we remember in a moment of quiet. We pray for those left behind with just their memories. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. Lord, as we go out from your house today, we rejoice in your love for us. Lead us into this coming week knowing that you are close by. When we face hard decisions or difficult work and enjoy ourselves while having fun with others, may we know that you share all these times with us, and may we be ready to tell others about you. Merciful Father, accept these prayers for the sake of your Son, our Savior Jesus Christ. Amen.
As our children are joining us, let us please stand as we begin. Isn't it lovely to see so many beautiful children in Sunday school? We are now one church. We're all together, one family. And they have a lot to say to each other. We are the body of Christ. In the one Spirit, we were all baptized into one body. Let us then pursue all that makes for peace and build up our common life. The peace of the Lord be always with you and also with you. Let us offer each other a sign of peace.
Our offertory hymn is number 310. Lord, for the years your love has kept and guided, urged and inspired us, cheered us on our way. 310. The Lord be with you. Lift up your hearts. Let us give thanks to the Lord our God. Father, we give you thanks and praise through your beloved Son, Jesus Christ, your living Word, through whom you have created all things, who was sent by you in your great goodness to be our Savior. By the power of the Holy Spirit, he took flesh. As your Son, born of the Blessed Virgin, and he lived on earth and went about among us. He opened wide his arms for us on the cross. He put an end to death by dying for us and revealed the resurrection by rising to new life. So he fulfilled your will and won for you a holy people. Therefore, with angels and archangels and all the company of heaven, we proclaim your great and glorious name, forever praising you and singing. Lord, you are holy indeed, the source of all holiness. Grant that by the power of your Holy Spirit and according to your holy will, these gifts of bread and wine may be to us the body and blood of our Lord Jesus Christ, who in the same night that he was betrayed, took bread and gave you thanks. He broke it and gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take, eat. This is my body which is given for you. Do this in remembrance of me." In the same way, after supper, he took the cup and gave you thanks. He gave it to them, saying, "Drink this, all of you. This is my blood of the new covenant, which is shed for you and for many for the forgiveness of sins. Do this as often as you drink it, in remembrance of me." Great is the mystery of faith. Christ has died. Christ is risen. Christ will come again. And so, Father, calling to mind his death upon the cross, his perfect sacrifice made once for the sins of the whole world, rejoicing in his mighty resurrection and glorious ascension, and looking for his coming in glory, we celebrate this memorial of our redemption. As we offer you this, our sacrifice of praise and thanksgiving, we bring before you this bread and this cup, and we thank you for counting us worthy to stand in your presence and serve you. Send the Holy Spirit and gather into one in your kingdom all who share this one bread and one cup, so that we, in the company of all the saints, may praise and glorify you forever through Jesus Christ our Lord, by whom and with whom and in whom, in the unity of the Holy Spirit, all honor and glory be yours, Almighty Father, forever and ever. Amen. Kneeling together, let us pray as our Savior has taught us. Our Father in heaven, hallowed be your name. Your kingdom come, your will be done, on earth as in heaven. Give us today our daily bread, and forgive us our sins, as we forgive those who sin against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For the kingdom, the power, and the glory are yours, now and forever. We break this bread to share in the body of Christ. Draw near with faith, receive the body of our Lord Jesus Christ, which he gave for you, and his blood, which he shed for you. Eat and drink in remembrance that Christ died for you, and feed on him in your hearts by faith with thanksgiving. We do not presume to come to this your table, merciful Lord, trusting in our own righteousness, but in your manifold and great mercies. We are not worthy so much as to gather up the crumbs under your table, but you are the same Lord, whose nature is always to have mercy. Grant us, therefore, gracious Lord, so to eat the flesh of your dear Son, Jesus Christ, and to drink his blood, that our sinful bodies may be made clean by his body, and our souls washed through his most precious blood, and that we may evermore dwell in him and he in us. Amen. We pray together. Almighty God, we thank you for feeding us with the body and blood of your Son, Jesus Christ. Through him we offer you our souls and bodies to be a living sacrifice. Send us out in the power of your Spirit to live and work to your praise and glory. Amen. Do the young people quickly want to share anything with us?
Sure.
Sure. Okay, I'm just going to ask three people today because I want to keep it speedy because I've got something else I need to do. Okay? So I'm going to start over there. Is that all right?
Yeah.
Thank you. I'm going to start with Sienna, who had her hand up first. Thank you very much, Sienna.
So when we, in our group, we were studying the Bible, obviously, and...
Good.
And there was about this tax guy, this official who wouldn't pay his debt. Uh-huh. And so, yeah, so the king said that he needed to pay his debt, but the guy pleaded, and so the king felt pity, and he let the guy, he let the guy go. So then the official saw the other official who owed him just 100 silver, whereas he owed the king like 50 million silver or something. And he was like strangling him, and he was so mad at him because the guy didn't pay him.
Loving this.
And then he put the guy in prison. So then the king heard of that, and he was mad at the official and put him in jail to get tortured until he could pay.
Didn't end well, did it? Okay.
No, and we also did a play on that. I was the evil official.
Okay, you were the evil official. I'm going to go over here to Phoebe, I think, is next.
Yes.
And I'm going to come to a guy.
Today in Sunday school, like Sienna was saying, we did a very fun little like role play or acting out of what the out of what that section of the Bible was.
Cool. And what did you learn from it?
We learned to forgive our sins, and there's no amount of times that you should forget someone.
Perfect, love that. It's not always easy, but we're going to give it a go. Guys, one of you want to do it?
Emily.
Emily. Okay, apparently Emily's got something that Miss Ruth wants her to say, right? Okay, Emily, go for it.
So, yeah, we did the play, and so, yeah, we would, row the guard, took Tiana in to see Harry the King, and then Phoebe was playing the wife of Sienna because Sienna was playing a boy and Nathan was playing their 3-year-old baby.
Okay. Does anyone have the translation? Okay. Very quickly, Lily. Okay, go on then.
So today we learned how to forgive other people.
Great. That's what we want to end with. That's awesome, Sauce. Thank you very much indeed. Let's give these young people a clap. But... okay, you guys all go back. I'm just going to keep hold of Ray for a minute.
Yeah.
All right, buddy. Okay. You're doing all right. So, as we all know, our friend Roe here, who we love to support, we think is awesome. Well, he's just let you know, he's going on a little trip, and we're just going to go, we're just going to pray for him now, all right, buddy? Okay, anything you're worried about? Tell us about. All right, let's pray for Ro. Heavenly Father, when we travel far away from home, we don't travel far away from you. You are always with us. And we pray that in his travels, Ro will know you, and that all along that journey, he'll discover more about himself, about you, how to live in the world, and that when he comes back, he will be so full of joy and love that he'll enjoy all the things that happen from here on after. And when they're hard, that he'll still know that you're with him in Jesus Christ. Amen. Thank you, Ray. Well done. Give him a little clap. You're the best, buddy. Okay. two very quick notices. First of all, it's vestry this week, and I'm sorry I've had to move it to Thursday. If you're in vestry and you're like, oh, for goodness sake, moved it to Thursday, we'll talk about it on Thursday, about how we move forward. I had to do it for some very good reasons, mainly it bubbled my sanity. So please, let's talk about that on Thursday, but that's when the meeting will be, 6:30 in the Barnabas room, as usual. The second notice is about the Theological Institute. So we've had our first meeting. It's been great. It's been going really, really well. We've got one small problem, in as much as we always used to have in the days before COVID. Do you remember the days before COVID? There was a little team of people who used to either make the food or serve the food or wash up after the food or collect the food from wherever it was being made. And now we don't have them. So what's happening is that my college administrator, my college administrator, Elsa, who you may know from the bishop's office as well, she's my administrator. She's supposed to be administrating 4 hours a week for me. But what she's having to do at the moment is serve food and make food. And that's kind of not working. So we need to reach out to all the parishes and say, the Theological Institute really needs people to come and do this. Now, if you've ever been to St. Miletus in London, you will actually see exactly the same people. They come from all lots of different churches, and they come and they volunteer by serving food and or collecting food or doing whatever it is and washing up afterwards. And it's a really lovely ministry. And everyone who comes along is welcome to sit in and on the class and listen if they want to. It's absolutely fine. So if you feel that that's your ministry, that's great. If you're sitting there thinking, well, I can't cook, but I could pick up some food, that's great, please do that. If you're thinking, I could cook some food, but I'm not sure I could afford it, don't worry, we cover all costs. We're a professional organization. We'll cover all your costs. It's just that we actually need the churches to be involved in supporting us by, as I say, either collecting food, producing food for which we will reimburse you, or clearing up, washing up, and making sure. It's a real lovely service ministry, and it's also a sneaky way to get in without having to write any essays. So do come and volunteer. It's not that bad, Sarah, it's fine. Do please come and volunteer if that's something you were thinking, oh, I could do that, actually. But please don't volunteer to me, because I'm not the one that runs it. Elsa is the one that runs it. If you're not sure about how to contact Elsa, she's in the diocesan office 5 days a week. And she is also available on email, diocese@anglican.bn. It's just the diocesan email. And she's also available on the telephone, 292-6987. It's in the book. And if you're still not sure, come and talk to me and I'll let you know. But I won't be the one to give you the information because I don't know. Because that's why I have an administrator, so I don't have to think about those things. So thank you. That's it, really. I don't think there's anything else except birthdays. Diana, do I have any birthdays? There are no birthdays. Nobody got born this week. I'm sure somebody did. Miss Victoria. Oh, right, that's an important notice. Yes, Church Girls Brigade begins this week. So that's Thursday at 6:30. There you go. So you're either going to end up in vestry or in Church Girls Brigade. Either will do. It all works out. I'm sure there's a birthday this week. I feel it. Oh, choir. Choir starts this week. If you want to come and sing in the choir, now's your chance. It's a good one to start with because Christmas is a-coming. So we'll be looking up for some people. Yes, oh, I know what it is. We're remembering our sister Margaret Kirk, whose birthday would have been on Saturday. So, Michael, we're praying for you, and we're certainly remembering Margaret. All right. Let's stand together and receive God's blessing. The peace of God, which passes all understanding, keep your hearts and minds in the knowledge and love of God, and of his Son, Jesus Christ our Lord, and the blessing of God Almighty, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit be among you and remain with you always. Amen. Our last hymn is a great hymn of praise from our Welsh sisters and brothers. Guide me, O thou great Redeemer, pilgrim through this barren land. If you know it in Welsh, you may sing it in Welsh.
Thank you.
We will enjoy a beautiful week this week. No more storms. I have spoken. No loss of electricity. I have spoken. And with that, go in peace to love and serve the Lord. In the name of Christ. Amen.